Welcome to Leadership and Life Chat with your hosts, me, James Lay.
And me, Mark Curtis. In each episode, we'll be illustrating how success in leadership is inextricably linked with success in life.
Whether it's leadership in business, society, family or friends, we're all leaders.
Using our experiences and a range of expert guests, we'll share secrets to boosting your health, wealth and self.
So let's get on with the show.
In this week's episode, we tackle something which is more feared than death.
Speaking on podcasts, Mark.
Speaking on podcasts, it would definitely
listening to our podcast is probably,
To ours would definitely be in most people's top three, James. But actually, today is something which every survey I've ever read comes out at pretty much number one, and that number one fear is public speaking. Now, today we're lucky enough to have a guest who not only specializes in public speaking but has had a highly successful business career, which has been very intrinsically linked to that as well. So, James, I think, you know, even though we're getting a bit long in the tooth ourselves, we're going to learn some stuff today. And I'm pretty sure the listeners are going to get some massive value out of today as well. So I'll share a little bit of background before we get going today, just to whet the appetite. He's had a 38-year business career at senior levels, became a director at the tender age of 21, was a founding fellow of the Institute of Sales Professionals, was a member of Toastmasters International from 1997 to 2014, and during that period was a multiple national and international speaking champion, including Humorous Tales. He's the author of two great books, James, which we've both read, which are Talk the Talk and Telling the Tale. And finally, the writer and presenter of one of my favourite podcasts, which is Stumpy Sanderson's 1970s Stories. So that just leaves me to say, Andrew Brammer, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, Mark. Thanks very much, James. Great to talk
Andrew,
to you.
Andrew, I've had the privilege to know you for several years. And in fact, I attended one of your public speaking courses many years ago. So I'm sure I've missed out some really important points in your journey. So to start with, would you like to share a little bit more about yourself and your story and your journey with our listeners?
I certainly would, Mark. Okay, I was born... Well, first of all, hello, everybody. My name's Andrew Brammer. I was born in 1963, 18 years after the end of the Second World War, 3 years before England won the World Cup, and 6 years before man landed on the moon. Working class lad, I went to a comprehensive school and then sixth form, and then I went into college where I'd done an HND in business studies. I had no interest whatsoever in business studies. I always wanted to be a rock musician, but you just drift into these things. And yeah, nearly 48 years later in manufacturing and engineering and business, I think, wow, how did I get here? I left college in 83, and my first job in 83 was in manufacturing, where I actually started off, believe it or not, as a cleaner in a salted nut processing factory. I spent a year there, possibly learned more about management or how not to manage people in that first year, which really held me in good stead. Then moved into sales admin, and after 4 or 5 years was promoted into a senior role, went into production management, then went into sales management for a global manufacturer of power steering systems. Stayed there till 96 and then moved to my current company, PSS Steering and Hydraulics Division in North Walsham, where we manufacture power steering equipment. So I've been here for 26 years now, of which 21/22 have been as a company director. So I'm the commercial director here at PSS. In tandem to all my business activities, one of the things I felt I really needed to develop, especially when I'd been promoted into management, and I felt like a lot of people do, really not very confident at all about speaking in front of people, etc. So I thought one of the big business skills I had to develop was public speaking. So I forced myself to go onto a course, you know, dreading it like everybody did, but I actually then fell in love with it, because I've always been a storyteller right from when I was a young age, and I've always loved appearing on stage and playing in bands, which is very different to actually speaking in a formal setting. So that's why I took up public speaking, to develop that side, but I fell in love with it and was able to dovetail my storytelling in with public speaking. And to cut a long story short, I'd done, in inverted commas, the public speaking for 17 years. I used to compete, I used to, in contests, I used to coach people, train people, ran all sorts of events. And at the same time, I was doing my storytelling, which really took off around 2009, where for 5 years I performed one-man storytelling shows in theatres and venues all around the UK and Ireland, and loved doing that. But then 2014, I'd done it for 17 years. I went out on a bit of a high, had two sold out shows back to back. And I thought, oh, that sort of brought that little chapter to an end. So I parked it up. But yeah, you never really park up stuff that you love doing. And during lockdown, although we worked all the way through lockdown, so I, again, in inverted commas, have not been locked down. I've been in work all the time. But my wife said to me, oh, you should really think about bringing your Stumpy Sanderson's 1970s stories back and putting them on podcasts. So I started thinking, yeah, yes, it's a cool idea. And I started writing again. I started playing my music again. And I started putting all that stuff together again. And yes, Stumpy Sanderson's 1970s stories are all now out on podcast, coming out. Two a month. I put my music out. I've got all sorts of things going on. Now I've got my own radio show as well on local community radio. So that's my hobby and that's my love and passion, dovetailed with the business. Some people say, how on earth do you get time to do all that stuff? And I just say, well, what do you do as a hobby? And someone might say, well, I play golf. And I say, well, I tell stories. It's a hobby. It's a love. It's a passion. And I feel it's really important to do that sort of thing, you know, to complement what you're doing in the business world.
That's a great summary, Andrew. Thank you for that. And I'm intrigued at a number of points that you could pick up on anything. The public speaking competitions that you're involved with on a national, international level, how do they work? I haven't come across those before.
Yeah, they were fun and games. So what we did, I belonged to an organisation called Toastmasters International, which nothing to do with red-coated Toastmasters whatsoever. So Toastmasters is like American speak for public speaker. Huge organisation worldwide, hundreds of thousands of members. And I joined a club based in Norwich, Norwich Speakers Club. And then a few years later, we actually set up our own club in North Walsham, which is my hometown as well. And basically, they had a couple of major speaking competitions during the year. One for, in inverted commas again, I keep using that phrase, inverted commas, for serious speech, which is like motivational, inspirational stuff.
Yeah.
And one for humorous speech. And basically, you write the speech, which you deliver without notes, sort of up to 7 minutes long, and you perform it in front of an audience. And as you go through the rounds, a bit like the FA Cup in football, the crowds get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. You eventually get to the national final, which is 500 people plus, and you deliver your 7 minute speech along with seven other.
So it's the same 7 minutes?
Same 7 minutes, yeah. Oh,
okay.
And in front with seven other contestants in there. And you are judged and scored and marked on various criteria. And then, yeah, they choose the winner. I was lucky enough, fortunate enough, 2000, I won the UK and Ireland Humorous Speech Championship.
Wow.
And I came third in the same contest in, I think it was 2004. And I reached three inspirational speech finals as well. So, yeah, it really gives you an opportunity to hone your skills and speak in front of an audience and get that message, try and get your message across. And I think why I love the humorous speech side was because it was storytelling and I could tell my humorous stories.
So is that one story that you do over the 7 minutes?
That was one story, yeah.
Big build-up. You need to get the finish done.
Yeah,
it
was great fun, and it taught me a heck of a lot, and it taught me as well how to compress a message into a fairly short space of time and how to work an audience. Because one of the great things with a humorous speech that you don't realise when you first set out on your journey, in your first round, you might have 20, 30 people in the audience, so it's fairly small. If you've got some real killer lines in there that really make people laugh, when you get to the final, because if you go over or under time, you're disqualified. You know,
How much wiggle room have you got?
30 seconds either side.
Okay.
But that is not a lot of time. And if you deliver, for example, a killer line in front of an audience of 500 and they all start laughing, you've got to take that into account. How long is the audience going to laugh for before I then move on to the next?
And but if you overestimate that,
then absolutely.
You need to fill as well.
I guess.
So James, if you did that, you just have to make sure it's a nailed 7 minutes then.
Yeah, I know.
So Andrew, I mean that's fascinating for me, because I think, you know, when you're talking about, you know, compressing a message, delivering it with clarity, presenting it potentially in front of 500 people, for most of us in business, we're never going to have to deliver a message to 500 people in all likelihood. And the one thing which I've found through my career is it's almost like, I think the Americans call it like the elevator pitch. But when you say to people, what do? Most people kind of goldfish at you. They don't know how to succinctly tell you in a captivating way what it is they do. So that must have been hugely valuable in your business career. So which came first? Was it the learning to do it in your speaking career, or did you learn it in business and then translate it into speaking? Which came first for you?
Yeah, it was a bit of both, really, Mark. I mean, being into a senior role at a fairly young age obviously meant I had to address people and that. So I was always doing it at work. Didn't feel comfortable with it, particularly, and I hope people don't take this the wrong way, When you're younger and put into a senior position, then talking to people who are quite a bit older than you, and you're trying to get you get this fear inside you that they're not really taking much notice of what I'm saying. They're just viewing me as a young whippersnapper. So there was a real confidence issue. So I was doing it at work for quite a long time, Mark and James. But then I realised that was a skill I need developing. So I was able to use the organisation I joined, Toastmasters, to start developing that. So I was doing it in tandem, really, always having to speak in front of groups at work, sometimes not very effectively at all, but then beginning to learn, right, these are the tricks on how to do it more effectively, and gradually the two met.
Yeah, I think it's great, Andrew, because lots of people, when they're in their careers, they look at training and they look at the technical side and how they need to improve in those areas, and yet communication is, you know, the most important skill of them all, and yet we often rely upon no training at all in that area. And you went sort of outside of your work environment, you went on to develop that side of it and the benefits. And it's not just that, is it? I mean, there's it's communicate. Go back to it, it's communication, and to be a good speaker, you've also got to be a good listener.
Absolutely.
And sort of rolling that out with family and friends and best man speeches and you know, whatever else it might be in our lives is. And it's a skill that that others are always, not always, often impressed by, because they put themselves in your shoes, Andrew, and think, I couldn't possibly do that. And they're already telling themselves they can't do it, when actually you may have had those same thoughts when you were starting out on this path.
Oh, absolutely. 100%, James. You know, Mark touched on it in the intro about it being a great fear, public speaking. And I've always thought the biggest fear, and certainly personally, and when I've talked to other speakers and that, the biggest fear is fear of failure and fear of looking ridiculous in front of your peers or other people. And that's, for some people, that's quite a hurdle to overcome. But I always think public speaking and anything with communication, you learn by doing. It's like riding a bike. Yeah. When you first get on your bike as a little kid, you hammer along, you fall off, you hurt yourself. But you get back on that bike and you do it again, and then you do it, fall off, and you do it again. You do it, and the more you do it with public speaking, and the more you do it with communication, the easier it does become. And
I know that from. I mean, I don't present anywhere near as many times as you have, Andrew. But I had a little run a couple of years ago when I had a number of presentations, sort of back to back. And Mark will know. I quite like to prepare for them in advance, and I take them far too seriously, and I'll do, you know, lots of practice runs, and I'll try and in front of a, you know, in fact one of the presentations I did in front of Mark in advance of that, and it was really useful. I got lots of points that he made, even his constructive criticism, but that was really helpful. But the confidence levels as it built up, and then by chance the following week I went to a conference in Budapest, and I thought it was a relatively easy conference and I was going to be sitting in the background, and I clearly hadn't paid attention, because suddenly on the opening morning, they talked about going round the room and everyone sort of giving a bit of a spiel about their business. And I don't remember this being on the agenda, but fair enough. And then the next thing you know, the first person sort of gets up and they turn their PowerPoint on, and you just think, oh, well, I haven't got a PowerPoint, he's going to stand out a bit. And then the next one stood up and they had a PowerPoint, and so on. And I'm last up. I've got no PowerPoint whatsoever.
Yeah.
And I'm making notes as they're doing their presentations. I'm trying to listen, but I'm also trying to make, well, what am I going to talk about? But because I'd done a number of presentations in the lead up to that, actually, what I'd learned from that, I was absolutely fine. I stood up and dare I say it, I think it went really well.
Yeah.
Partly because I hadn't needed to prepare in advance for it, but the confidence from doing several presentations in the weeks leading up to that, it was no problem. But had I not had that, would have been really difficult.
Yeah, which goes back to the point, the more and more you do something, the more comfortable you feel with it. And I've always felt as well, or I'll just quickly interject here, just for the listeners' benefit here, just to prove that this is a live environment, because I'm actually talking from our factory here, manufacturing factory in North Walsham, and you might occasionally hear some banging from outside, and that is a couple of our, let's just have a look, a couple of our lads proving that, you know, we've got plenty of work on at the moment. They're hammering away on some gearbox differentials for one of our major customers. So that's gearbox differentials. You don't hear that in a podcast very often.
You don't. We're going to put that in the search engine wording.
Is that linked to a Synchromesh gearbox?
Synchromesh gearbox. Yeah, it's yeah, and we actually started doing these 18 months ago. So it's a significant new piece of business for us. So really good.
Brilliant. So just following on, I think one of the things that I've just picking up on an earlier point, Andrew, you said that, you know, you chose to go down the route of sort of Toastmasters and public speaking to build your confidence around delivery of messages. Be really interested in your view. So I can think about the first presentation skills course I ever went on, and it was an internally ran course with a couple of the senior partners, as it would have been back in the day. And it was one of those cringeworthy events where you had to do a 10-minute presentation, and they filmed you on a VHS camcorder, and then 10 people in the room did their 10 minutes. It was really awful. And then you spent the rest of the day basically pulling and ripping everyone to shreds about how awful they were. And at the end of it, you went away thinking, right, I'm never, ever going to do any presentations again. So I'm guessing you probably wouldn't think that's the best way to go about developing your skills and learning. So if you were going to put advice out to people who are listening to this podcast about, you know, ways and means to develop it and routes they could go down, what would you recommend?
Right, the first thing, the great thing about Toastmasters International, I'm not a member of them anymore, but I was for 17 years, but the fantastic thing we did there, there was no such thing as criticism. And when I delivered my public speaking courses and coaching for people as well, no one was criticised. That is absolute. That is, you know, that is like that in a vampire film and hanging up the garlic. That's just something you do not do. We used to have what we called positive feedback evaluation. So you were always encouraging people. So rather than say you shouldn't have done that, which is going back to your point, Mark, is what makes you think I'll never want to do this again. It's, oh, you did this like this. Perhaps next time you might want to think about doing this, this and this, because that'll add to your message. And the effect that has on people's confidence is amazing. So it's a very supportive environment. So I would strongly recommend anyone who wants to develop their communication skills looks to join a speaking club. You know, you're with fellow-minded individuals who are all on the same journey. Some are at different levels, whatever, but they're all there to support and encourage people. And there are hundreds of these speaking clubs all around the UK. I mean, then, as I mentioned earlier, there's one in Norwich, there's one in Durham, in Norfolk, and we've got loads all over the country. I would strongly recommend that you join a speaking club or find a coach or a mentor. And obviously, you can read books on public speaking. I mean, I've written one myself, but you can read books, but you can only learn by doing. And the more you're doing it, the more you encourage feedback from people. So if you do a little presentation, do it in front of, if you've got a presentation coming up, do it in front of some friends or some family, which family is the hardest audience, but that is awesome, because encourage feedback. Say, oh, what did you like about what I did? And what do you think I could perhaps work on? And just start absorbing feedback like a sponge. Mm.
What about calming nerves, Andrew? I mean, there's I always think with public speaking, there's kind of two sets of nerves to control. The first is in the weeks or months even leading up to the presentation.
Yep.
With that sort of sense of, for some people, sense of dread that it's coming.
Yeah.
I've got 3 months to prepare for it. Oh, you know, it hangs over them. And then there's the actual sort of day itself. And, you know, maybe you're sitting in the audience and you're ready to get up on stage, or you're behind the scenes, whatever it might be. And which is a slightly different sort of, you know, it's much more urgent at that point. You've got to have the courage to get up there.
Yeah.
So how do you deal with those two, what advice do you give to people in those two scenarios leading into a presentation?
The biggest help I can and advice I can give on nerves on is preparation. What's the old saying? If you fail to prepare, you prepare to fail. So the more preparation you've put into your presentation, so we go back, Mark, to the weeks before the event, that's your preparation time. The more you can drill that, and I don't mean learning something word for word, but just getting it to be part of your system. If you've got plenty of weeks preparation, which isn't always possible, sometimes you have to speak impromptu, but if you've got a few weeks before, that's your time to write your presentation, to prepare your presentation, and to actually know it inside out. So if you slip up, you know, you know internally that you know what you're going to be doing. And that is really the best advice on preparation. Practice as much as you can before the event as well. And a lovely little tip as well, so if you've got things like time pressure going on before your presentation, the great tip I learned and then I always used to pass on to someone, if someone says you've got to do a 10-minute presentation, do an 8-minute presentation and deliver it in 10.
Yeah.
So always aim to come in well under, and then you've got that extra time. You're not under the time pressure. You've got more time to relax on the speaking platform, etc. And then, James, the nearer and nearer you get to the event, and particularly on the day of the event, there's all sorts of techniques you can do. There's I used to teach people the breathing techniques, the way you move around the stage, etc. Which the more you're moving, the more your actually body's working in harmony with what you're saying, and you just start naturally to relax. I'm going to chuck something in here that might be a little bit semi-controversial, because one of the things I was taught and I always used to teach people was everyone wants you to do well. If you put that little nugget in your head, everyone wants you to succeed. Unless somebody is completely warped in that audience, you're going to go out there. No one wants to see you fall on your face, make an idiot of yourself, and completely slip up. So if you've got that mindset, people want to listen to your message. And if you've got that drilled into you, that's a massive help for your self-confidence. The controversial bit of that is you're sometimes in senior positions or sometimes in a speaking contest, and you've got other contestants thinking, "Man, I wish he slipped up." So it's not always true, but 90% of the time, most people want you to do well. And if you remember that is a great thing. And don't be afraid. And with your nerves as well, don't be afraid to make mistakes.
Yeah,
really, do not be afraid to make that. That's what makes us human, and that's what. Sometimes mistakes are the great bits. And also the other thing with mistakes, most people won't notice you've made it.
Yeah.
It's only you that would know.
If you've missed a bit out, they wouldn't know.
Yeah, no one else would know.
Yeah. I often think that when you're leading into that moment that you stand up on stage, actually just putting a smile on your face and trying to reframe it, you can be terrified or you can be excited. And actually the body reacts in almost the same way. It's just the thought processes that are going
absolutely.
In their head. You know, and if you can spin it that way and almost like tell yourself, I'm really excited by this. I can't wait to get up there. I can't wait to get my message across.
Yeah. So,
then it's the same. Your body feels the same way as it does when it's terrified, but it's much more positive. And you know, you can once you get that first line out as well, that's the hardest part almost. It's a bit like going for a run. Hardest part is putting your trainers on, going out the door. Yeah, it's almost the same with speaking as well. It's actually getting that first sentence out.
I was relieved when you said this was going to be a controversial one. I thought you were going to condone the use of some sort of substance there.
Oh, no. That's another thing as well. Yeah, never, ever. I know horses for courses, and everyone has their own ways of preparing for things. But my advice would massively be as well, never have a drink before you give a presentation.
Yeah.
Never. So you want to take away as many of the things that you can, that could go wrong, that you can control before you get up there. And also other things, going back, James, to on the day of the thing, make sure you've checked the venue out and all sorts of things like your sound equipment. Get there early, give yourself plenty of time, go up there, walk around on the platform where you're going to be speaking. So make yourself comfortable in that room. The last thing you want to do is roll up 10 minutes before you've got to give your presentation and walk into a strange environment. And if you can, mingle and network and mix with members of the audience before. That's always great. And when you're actually up there on the stage as well, you know, if you could spot some friendly faces that you've already made contact with, that's a really nice tool to use if you have been feeling nervous.
The other thing which I used to do, because I had to control my own mind, because it's all about controlling your own mind really, and getting the right messaging in your own head, isn't it? And I used to use positive mantras around it, and I would do it like even if I was practicing a presentation when I was out walking the dog. You'd still feel the nerves build up when you, even if you're in the middle of the countryside, no one else around, because suddenly your head is in the position of where you're going to be when you're on the stage or whatever it might be. So I would continually tell myself out loud, Mark, you're a great public speaker. People love to listen to you, which was all well and good until you turned a corner in a field and there was someone walking the other way with their dog as well. But I did. I had to use positive mantras, and I'd do it in the car as well, driving to the venue, just to try and, well, you believe what you tell yourself. So give yourself the right messaging as well.
That's a great little tip. I mean, we're drifting a bit there into some NLP type territory, but just a little anecdote there about that. Sometimes with my storytelling shows, and there was one particular story that I used to perform that actually went down a real storm. And sometimes before I had a big show, I used to, then this, the story was called Judd Kinsey's Bugle. And before I went on stage, I used to put my fingers together in a little sort of self message and just go, Judd Kinsey's Bugle. And that brought back to me the response for the audience from these previous shows, and then I'd hit the stage. And a friend of mine who was a public speaking coach, he had to coach a chap who had been asked to be best man to one of his friend's wedding. It was going to be across in the States, and he absolutely was petrified. I mean, this was affecting him physically, mentally, etc., etc. My friend took him through the process. And he started off by saying, if you could be anything in the world or anybody, who would it be and what would it be? And he said, Steven Gerrard leading Liverpool out at Anfield. And he switched him into this technique.
Yeah.
And he said, before you deliver that speech, and he saw a video playback of the speech afterwards and it went down a storm. He said, you stand there before you go out. I'm Steven Gerrard leading Liverpool out at Anfield. And he used that technique to build his confidence up, and it 100% worked. And this guy had been absolutely petrified, never given a speech in his life, and delivered a cracker.
So this is going back in your books, you refer to anchoring.
Yes.
Which again, you mentioned NLP. Yep. Mark and I are also practitioners in that. But for the benefit of the listeners, how might somebody go about replicating that then, that in terms of using an anchor?
Yeah, well, I mean, I haven't used that technique because I haven't performed on stage for 8 years now, I think, James, the last time. But yeah, so that little Judkins's Bugle example I gave was an example of the anchoring, you know, where I recalled something that had happened that was really, really good for me, I was in a good place, it was successful, it was making people laugh. And I recalled that memory, all the visions of it, all how I felt at the time. How did I feel when that, you know, when I delivered that story? How did I feel being able to interact so closely and brilliantly with the audience? Tried to recreate that in my head, and then just had this little, when I put my fingers together, I think it was my thumb and my third finger, and I'd anchor that Judkins's bugle and bring all those memories flooding back, how I felt and how my, you know, bodily and in person and in my mind, and then just went out. Yeah, so that was the sort of anchoring I would use.
Can be very powerful. I know Mark and I have used that.
Yeah, should we tell a little story about anchoring with olfactory senses, James? Is it worth just sharing that with Andrew?
So
as James said, we're NLP practitioners ourselves, but I actually went on a course with Jordan Belfort, the Real Wolf of Wall Street, and he's big into NLP, and one of the things he was talking about is the fact that apparently they've proven scientifically that the most powerful sense we have is our olfactory, our sense of smell. So if you're going to anchor on something, you should anchor on a sense of smell, because
rather than a sight or a sound.
I have vivid memories of my gran baking like shortcakes and stuff, and I can smell it and I'm back in the room. So I thought, okay, I get this. So so he recommended these thing called, what they call, boom boom sticks.
That's right.
Boom boom sticks. So anyway, James ordered some. They came from America. You know, have no idea whether they're legal in the UK. Hopefully they are, because I've still got some in the house. And honestly, they came in these packs and we hadn't even opened them. And the smell was like so intense. We haven't even opened them. So we were sitting in a room with one of our colleagues, and this colleague decided they were going to have a little sniff of theirs just to see what it was like. And honestly, it's a bit like a Vic Sinex stick is what it looks like. Wow. I mean, honestly,
it's a strong anchor.
It was a strong anchor. I mean, I suspect theirs is not a good anchor, because they couldn't see for 5 minutes. Their eyes were streaming. Oh, dear. So, so apparently olfactory anchoring is the most powerful one.
The most powerful. Wow.
Okay. But we all know that anchoring works, because as you say, like the tastes and things like that can take you back. Music, etc., can all take you back to a certain state.
Yeah.
Maybe linking it to past experiences.
Absolutely.
Using that in a constructive way, because it's very easy, particularly if you have a bad presentation, if there is such a thing, with you know what you were saying earlier. But if one doesn't go quite to plan, it's very easy to replay that in your mind and bring back those memories. And it's actually a case of just parking that.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have to be a presentation that you bring back to mind. It's just be a positive experience to get you in the right state, so that when you stand up on stage, you give yourself the best possible chance. And what I loved in the book, sorry Andrew, don't interrupt, but I really loved in your book reading through that, was two things. Firstly, it's a really streamlined book. I love that.
you
cut straight to the chase in lots and lots of bullet points, lots of clarity over that. I'd thoroughly recommend people getting a copy of the Talking the Talk book that you've got. But you refer to effectively presentation being like the tip of the iceberg, that like 10% of the iceberg that everybody can see, and all of the other stuff, you know, is the hard work that goes into it. There are people perhaps that just walk up on stage and get away with it, but the vast majority actually, you know, it's not that easy. You do have to really work hard at it.
Absolutely. It's all about the preparation. And I mean, when I used to do my storytelling shows, so they were like an hour and a half, so two halves of 45 minutes with a 15-20 minute interval, so there were four stories. And over the hour and a half, I used to rehearse that whole show before I hit the stage. And so this was no notes. This was just one man performance story.
Yep.
40 times.
Yeah.
Before I hit the stage.
Yep.
And that was the iceberg. So the 10% when I performed on the stage was people watching and listening. But all the work had gone in the weeks before that, in the rehearsal and preparation for it.
And that really helps, isn't it? It's a competence builds confidence.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So if you know your stuff,
yeah,
then you're much more likely to feel comfortable getting up there. Because actually, the worst, and also, I guess, 40 goes at it, if for an hour and a half. That's, you know, it's many hours that you're throwing at it. But there will be times where maybe, you know, you missed a bit out and you worked out absolutely. How to work around that. So again, that, you know, the ability to work around stumbles and work around issues. And what about heckling? Do you ever have to deal with that?
I've had some
I've had some
interjections, and one of the great things we used to do at Toastmasters, we used to have a thing called an R counter. And sometimes, particularly television presenters, you'll hear them saying, "Oh, so I was, yes, so the news today, yes, and I was walking along the road, and yes, and every time we erred or ummed in Toastmasters, we had this electric buzzer, and someone would buzz it.
I thought you said you're going to get electric.
Yeah, yeah. There is a club in Wisbeach that does.
That's not a public speaking one.
We used to buzz ums, and that not only helped you with your room, that helped you with distractions. So if you're suddenly in full flow, for example, giving a speech, and say it's an after dinner speech, and somebody's walking along, and drops a tray, suddenly you're taken off course. But if you've had the training where you're used to it doesn't faze you. And moving on to the heckling, James. Yeah, I mean, I've had some interjections before, and particularly when I set out on the journey in my early days of performing. We go back to Wisbeach now. There was a place in Wisbeach where somebody just chucked something out. But again, if you've prepared, it won't faze you. Yeah. And again, it's the more you do it as well. And you've just got to take it as part of the learning process. And you think, okay, how did I handle that? Right, next time I'll do this, and this time I'll do this. And sometimes heckling, well, not heckling, but interjections are great because you can bounce off the audience. And one of the crucial, what you're trying to do with public speaking is connect with the audience. And if you're able to do that, have that connection and interaction, that's great. What you've got to be able to do, though, is control it.
Yeah.
Particularly, yeah. I've seen so many people handle Q&A sessions at the end of their presentation, and it just goes wildly out of control, because you will always get some smart aleck in the audience who thinks they know more than, and you can go down a rabbit hole.
That's often been my fear in the past of public speaking is questions I don't know the answer to. So how you talked about controlling the Q&A sessions at the end. How do you go about that, Andrew?
Be honest. Don't try and cover up if you don't know the answer. So saying you, James, had asked me a question at the end of one of my presentations, and I would say something like, "Fantastic question, James. I don't have the answer for that at the moment, but if we touch base afterwards, you give me your contact details, etc., I'll find out for you and come back to you." Then move on. Don't go down the rabbit hole.
Nip it in the bud and move on.
Absolutely.
So Andrew,
and actually put the onus back on the questioner there, in terms of them reaching out and giving you their contact details.
Yeah.
Were they just trying to trip you up?
Yeah.
Or are they genuinely interested in the answer? If they are, they'll come and see you, won't they? So
So
Andrew, getting a bit more into sort of the mechanics of how we do some of this stuff. If you were going to give some sort of top tips to our listeners around presentations, how do you deliver a really powerful presentation? What are the constituent? We've done all the build up bit about the present, like, you know, sort of the practice, but how do you sort of construct a powerful presentation? And that maybe maps into how you construct stories within it as well. But how would you go about structuring it?
Right. The first thing is you want to get in your head, or you want to get down on paper what you're trying to get across to your audience. What is the main message? What is the fundamental thing that you're trying to get across to that audience to make that connection with? And what do you want them to get out of this presentation? And put yourself as well in the audience's shoes. So first of all, you want to be saying to yourself, if I was in the audience, what do I want to be listening to, and what do I want to learn from this presentation, from this speaker? And once you've got that, that gives you the basis for them writing your content. You then structure your content. My key advice would be with any presentation would be to keep it simple. You're not trying to deliver a textbook. And people will only remember a certain number of points. And three is such a great number. You know, try and get three main points across. I know sometimes if you've got to give an hour or hour and a half of rambling monologue, you know, you're going to cover more than three. But also try and break it up, because people's attention span is, I think we done a study once at Toastmasters and it came out as something like 11 minutes was the attentions before people started switching off with a presentation. So if you've got to deliver an hour's presentation, that gives you a challenge. And so what we used to do there was break it up into segments. Yeah. So you do like a 10-minute bit, whatever, and then something completely off the wall or something, and then you bring the audience back. And yeah, keep your content simple. Keep it, if you can, and we'll come on to obviously stories in a moment, I guess, because stories are so powerful to put in there. You know, make a point, tell a story. People will never remember points all the time, but they will always remember a story that you hang on that point. And just flipping onto that, I in my time, I went to see some world-class speakers, you know, people who do it for a living, and they were world-class. And I remember going to a conference once in Birmingham, years ago, and these were world-class speakers being paid a lot of money. And I came back to my speakers club at Norwich and I went, oh, you should have gone to this conference. It was amazing. It was absolutely fantastic. We had these eight speakers. They were doing it. They were dancing around on the stage. The body language, they had us all laughing, this, that, and the other. And one of them said to me, one of the people at Norwich speakers club said, oh, what did they speak about? And I was like, and there was only one speaker the week after that event I could remember the content for. And that was the speaker that used stories. And I can still remember some of that speaker's stories 15 years later. And that taught a great lesson to me. Make a point, tell a story.
And I love what you opened up there. You talked about asking yourself what your main message is.
Yep.
And putting yourself in your audience's shoes in terms of what they want. And I think that really helps for those that may be struggling with nerves leading into a presentation. Is trying to take yourself out of the equation. It's not actually about you.
No.
It's about the message you're trying to get
across.
And once you realise that you're in their service, and actually, you know, you want to entertain everything else, but it's not that if you take forget that they're judging you or anything else, just focus on the message that you're getting across. Suddenly it takes you out of the feelings.
Yes.
And gives you much more focus.
Yeah.
You know, forget about yourself. It's all about the audience.
It's all about
delivering your message.
Yeah.
And it's important. If it's not important, you really shouldn't be up there.
No, absolutely. And great point, James. And as we touched on, you know, the audience are there because they want to learn something or listen to something. And it's your job as the communicator to get that across and to get that across as simply and most effectively as possible.
Yeah.
As you move on in your journey, what I would recommend as well, and this is certainly not when you're at the beginning, although some people do it, is don't be afraid to do something different and be memorable. You want to be remembered. You don't. Yeah. If you're on the platform with eight other speakers, and at the end everyone just walks out of the day's conference, and that was okay, but if you can do something where people still years later are going, God, do you remember that guy or that lady who stood up on that stage and done this, and be memorable?
Sometimes it can be to distinguish yourself from other speakers. Sometimes it can be the tiniest things.
Oh, absolutely.
It can be that you didn't stand behind the lectern, but you actually walked around the stage a little bit. You engaged with them, or you started the presentation. You mingled within the audience, or you asked questions. You know, often you go to conferences, and they can be a bit dull, can't they, and repetitive.
One of the best presentations I ever heard was bizarrely in the World Championship of Public Speaking final. So you had about 2,000-3,000 people in the audience or whatever it was. Remember at the beginning we said where you're timed as well, you've got your 7 minutes.
Yeah.
This guy came on, introduced him. As soon as you're introduced, the clock starts. They said, Craig Valentine, da-da-da-da-da-da. And he just stood there, silence, for about the first 20 seconds, and everyone in the audience, you could see them fidgeting as he lost the plot, as he forgotten his word.
The drama.
His speech was all about the power of silence.
Yeah.
And he opened with silence. And I mean, that was crikey, 25 years ago or something? I can still remember watching the video of that speech, yeah.
Yeah.
And that's memorable.
So what about stories then, Andrew? This is the classic NLP. I've got to be careful what I say. I'm a terrible storyteller. So how can the likes of me be better at it?
Are we talking personal stories? Because they're always the best stories, personal stories that you can that have happened to you or the experiences in your life. So I would recommend anyone telling stories draw on experience. And anyone who's ever said to me, oh, I can't tell a story, I haven't got a story, rubbish. We're all made of stories. My favourite ever storytelling quote is from Ruth Stotter, who's a storyteller. And Ruth said, some people think we're made of flesh and blood and bones. Scientists say we're made of atoms, but I think we're made of stories. For when we die, that's what people remember. The stories of our lives and the stories that we told. And we are all made of stories. So everyone is full of stories. So your material's there. Then you've obviously got to use the techniques for storytelling, and they're very simple. You know, we all grow up listening to stories. We're exposed to stories all the time, on television, in books, whatever. It's very simple. It's just a way of putting your own stamp on those. You've got to think about things like structure, which is what I call... I use three letters to sum up how to put together a story, which is action, characters, and eloquence. ACE storytelling. Action, characters, and eloquence. An action is all about your structure. You've got to think, which is basically plot as well. What is my story going to be about? What is the key plot of this? How am I going to structure it? How am I going to move the audience from the start of the story, point A, to the end of the story, point Z? And what's going to happen in between? And the most important thing on your plot or putting together a story is you have to have conflict in there. Whether you're telling a personal story, a business story, whatever, if your story does not have conflict, it's not a story. It's just a recitation of events. I'll give you a very, very quick example of conflict. Let's just have a sentence. I took a swig from my pint of Guinness. That's just a sentence. Let's put some conflict in. I took a swig from the tattooed thug's pint of Guinness. And straight away we've got conflict. Yeah. And conflict is what makes your audience think, whoa, where's this going? What's going to happen next? Oh my goodness, if I was in that situation, what would I do? Ugh, what's that tattooed thug going to do to Andrew for taking a swig out? Straight away, it almost works on a subliminal level as well, and you're getting the audience thinking, where's this heading? And if you have conflict, and the more conflict in your story, obviously if you're telling a short story, you haven't got as much room to do that, but a longer story, you can start layering and layering and layering the conflict. And conflict as well, you know, razor blades, it's great. I'm an old traditionalist. I still use the old single razor blade, double-edged razor. But now I think someone's doing seven blades, aren't there? There's seven. And that's a bit like...
Mark and I wouldn't know. We haven't shaved in about 3 years, I don't think, but yeah.
Well, yeah. That's a bit like conflict. Some people say, oh, there's 15 types of conflict that you can put in your story. I was always taught there's four basic types of conflict. That's person versus person, person versus nature, person versus themselves, and person versus society.
Yeah.
So person versus person, person versus nature, person versus themselves, person versus society. And if you watch any great film, read any great book, and you can start working out where the conflict's coming from. And the more conflict you add into your story, the better and the more effective. That's what draws the audience in. And when we talked in public speaking about making that connection with the audience, that's what makes the connection in storytelling. That's what enables the audience to be drawn in. And then we start moving on to things like characters, and we make the characters come alive as well in stories, in our storytelling, because audiences relate to other people. So the more you can make your characters come alive, and, you know, not just be passport photos, but, you know, with description and dialogue, etc., and how they respond to that conflict is what makes that personal connection with your audience.
Yeah.
And then the third bit was eloquence. So that is just your choice of language, you know, and that's a personal choice. You know, you might want to use simple language in your stories. I like to flower mine up with really descriptive language to try and appeal to the senses. So it makes the audience, you want your audience to be able to close their eyes and imagine they're there.
Yeah.
In the scene.
And I think if anyone wants, I mean, we know that through history, great orators have been revered, you know, yep. Good and bad. You know, it can be used for good and bad. We know that. But I think if anyone wants to, I mean, we mentioned it in the intro, Andrew, but your Stumpy Sanderson's podcast, if anyone wants to hear you in true action, then I just recommend they take a listen to that, because, you know, all of those constituent parts you were talking about there are in each and every episode of what you deliver. The other big thing which comes through for me is the tone you use and the variation of tone, but also the variation of speed in your speech as well. So when you're really kind of building something up, and it's like a crescendo, you raise your voice, you get quicker. When you're building it, you talk slower, more deliberately, almost staccato. And just the way you're using your voice is captivating when I listen to those stories.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. That proves I'm doing my job. And the technique I use there in storytelling is exactly the same technique that we can use in public speaking. And, you know, we talked about things you put in your speech and that. And that's all about the delivery as well. So, you know, when you're putting something together, and particularly if you're trying to be different as well and put yourself in the audience's shoes, you know, they don't want to hear something rattling along at the same speed and same pace and same level of volume, etc., etc. They sometimes would like to hear it just slow down, then a pause, and then you're speeding up again as we're racing through the action scenes, etc., etc. And it's like a piece of music.
Yeah,
you're putting together something that's like a piece of music. And I also, with storytelling and public speaking, when you're putting your speech or your story together, I use two analogies, with two metaphors, where it's either like a piece of music or a bowl of vegetable soup. You're chucking all the ingredients in, and then you're thinking, well, perhaps I don't want some of that this time, but, oh, I want some more of that, and I want some more flavouring there. And you're just building something that's different every time.
And this is useful for presentations, but also in everyday business as well, isn't it? Because one of the things that I guess is easy to forget when you're experienced in whatever line of work that you've got is this sort of treasure chest of war stories,
yeah,
that
absolutely.
You can dip into.
Absolutely.
And the, you know, to win, for instance, to win new work,
yeah.
You can present the attractions and benefits of your services, the features of all of that, but being able to dip into war stories to really bring those things to life, as in, you know, and I guess it's easy to forget that you've got access to these things, and making a note of those stories as
yeah.
you go along and keeping them in mind, but actually doing a run through of them and building the drama a little bit with them, so you don't. You know, that you don't waste the opportunity that maybe that war story presents you. You don't miss a key bit of information that perhaps you provide it a bit blandly when you could have, you know, built a little bit of drama and an extra interest in there. It is, you know, I suggest that, you know, we all sort of think about where those key stories are in our business that people are going to be interested in and refine them. You talked about the 10% of the iceberg and stuff.
Yeah.
Don't just trot them out in front of
a
client or prospective client. Actually, you know, practice them a bit. Knock them about with your teams.
Absolutely,
you know,
James. Yeah.
Understand whether or not you're really getting your key point across and whether it could be delivered in a better way.
Yes. And you made a great point there about noting it down. That's another tip I would give. Keep a journal. Any idea or any spark that comes into your head or any story, write it down and just build that treasure chest up over the years. I mean, if we can see behind me, you see my picture there of the Apollo 11. That's the Saturn V rocket launching off. So when I was a kid, you know, that was a big thing for me, watching that take off and that. So that took men to the moon, and that's on there. There's a little story behind why that's there as well, apart from I love it. When any of my engineers or guys would come into my room and say, "Oh, we've got to put this project together for a customer. Oh, this is going to take 10 or 12 weeks to do this. This is going to take 14. I just point to that. They don't do it anymore. But I point to that and I said, in 1960, John F. Kennedy stood up and said, "We're going to put a man on the moon before this decade's out." They had no idea how they were going to do it. Da-da-da-da-da. Done it within 9 years. So it's not going to take us 14 weeks to put this together for a...
Difficult to argue with that one, isn't it? Although their budget was quite high.
Yeah, well, that's, yeah.
I think just bringing it back to sort of your sales career, Andrew, and one of the things that I was reading once is about how in sales you need to emotionally, it's not just, it's the features and benefit things, but it's also the emotional connection to your product and service, and painting a picture for people, how they're going to feel in the future once they've consumed your product or service, how their life is going to be better, so positive intent. And I'm guessing the best way we can do that is by delivering it as a story.
Yes, yeah, totally agree with you there, Mark. And you know, if we switch here to like television, and you see some of the great little adverts that are put together where people are telling stories, you know, to get that product across, and the. You know, some of the adverts that we remember over the years and that stick in our heads, you know, are almost like mini little 30-second, 60-second stories that are, you know, I mean, the famous one, isn't it, is the John Lewis Christmas adverts and whatever. Yeah. They tell the little story. And, yeah, you're trying to make that connection with your customer, with your audience, whatever. The principles are the same.
Because their message is essentially, come into our stores, shop online, we've got these products.
Yes.
But they don't use the 30 seconds or a minute or whatever it is that they pay for to advertise that. It's the feeling that they're trying to communicate, which they hope they can align with the brand, isn't it?
Yeah. And going back to your point there, Mark, you know, the thing with sales over the years, and again, we talk about the connection with the audience here. You know, one of the things I like to... Although I've been in sales all these years, I'm going to use the inverted commas again, a bit cliched. I don't class myself as a salesman. You know, I've always tried to build that rapport and that relationship with customers. Almost, you know, some of my customers I'm still friends with years after that they've left the business or whatever, because you're making that connection the same you are with presentations or storytelling. We're all people. You're just trying to make that connection with, you know, with your audience, with your customer, with your client. You know, we're all in this together. We might be doing different things, etc., but we're all part. You know, we're all striving to work together, and you make that connection. And, you know, with our products and that, yes, you know, I've tried to sort of explain and illustrate to people, you know, oh, this would be a real benefit, and when we use this product on this for this, and it done this, and it can, and yeah, you paint that little picture, but, you know, in an honest and genuine way.
So, conscious of your time, Andrew, and we always end with a couple of key questions. And I guess first up would be, other than your two fantastic books that you have yourself, which I've got in front of me, and which I would thoroughly recommend, Talking the Talk and Telling the Tale, by Andrew Brammer, available, I'm sure, in all good bookstores and probably...
quite old now, actually. I think about 9 years old, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, but still available.
They're still out there. It's still available. But other than your own two books, what perhaps three books or films or podcasts or whatever you can think of, would you recommend that our listeners consume?
Okay, well, I've had a long and hard think about this, and I've changed my mind so many times. I'm a voracious reader. I'm reading all the time. I'm a massive film buff. I'm a massive music lover. So the trove I was sort of mining for all this was...
You narrowed it down. I've managed
it down. So there's a book called Kennedy by Theodore Sorensen, Ted Sorensen, who was Jack Kennedy's speechwriter. I'm massively into US political history, and well, you can probably see because of the rocket behind me, you know, JFK was my political hero. But read that book, because that is such an amazing book about leadership, about the leadership, the way Kennedy used to make his decisions, surround himself with the best people. He would get all their opinions, counsel their views, then he would make the decision. That's leadership.
Yeah.
And also as well, particularly, you know, with the grim things we're going through at the moment, so I thought this was appropriate. You know, his decision making when the world was on the edge of the, too long ago for you guys to remember, and it was the year before
Not
I
Mark,
was born. But I was, you know, my mum and dad had just got married then. But you know, the world was on the precipice with the Cold War, and you read the first-hand account here of what that decision making was like, where you had to make the right decisions at the right time, otherwise none of us would be here. Awesome book. So it's really thick, really, really thick book, but really great read. Kennedy by Ted Sorensen. I'm going to move on now. I'm going to actually have a couple of films here. We talked about conflict earlier, and even though this is, a lot of people have seen this, rewatch Jaws by Steven Spielberg, 1975. Conflict. Spielberg is a master. He has every piece of conflict in there. So the first piece going, man v nature, man versus the shark, man versus man. There's all sorts of things where they're all against the mayor, personal conflicts. Man versus himself, Brody's fear of water, man versus society, one part not wanting to close the beaches, the other. Spielberg just layers all this conflict on. Apart from it being a phenomenal film, for a lesson in how to build conflict, it is absolute masterpiece. And the third one, I've changed this. I've got so many crossings out here, but I am going to go back now. And again, because when we're, you know, the time we're speaking at the moment, you know, there's some really dark things going on in this world. I'm going to point to the Saturn V rocket there, and I'm going to go back to the film Apollo 11, which came out in 2019, which is the actual documentary film put together and footage by NASA.
It's great.
It is awesome. And that tells you and would tell the audience, when we as human beings put our minds together and work together, what we can achieve. So forget all the dark stuff. We can also achieve phenomenal stuff.
That film is fantastic, and it
spine tingling.
Almost, it's when you see it, it's almost unbelievable. I know there are some sort of views that perhaps it is unbelievable. But it was just incredible what they've done, and you know, that if you think how long ago that was from a technological perspective. It was a huge achievement, wasn't it?
It was unbelievable. And I remember watching it. You know, my mum and dad woke us up, and we watched the Walking on the Moon. And in school, we were taken into the assembly area to watch film of Saturn V rocket. And so to me, it's got a very personal spin, but it's just incredible. And I once went to listen to one of the astronauts speak, and it's just unbelievable. It's just... And anyone, did you touch there, oh, James, on saying, or if it did happen, is that the conspiracy thing?
Well, what? Yeah, I'm not with those conspiracy theories, but I have to say, watching the film, I can understand why there are conspiracy theories, because it just looks so far-fetched when they break it down, what they had to, what they would, you know, they're up against.
All I would
and
say
go back to the technology at that time, you know, it would be hard enough now. But.
Awesome. All I would say to conspiracy theorists is, okay, what about Apollo 12, 14, 15, 16, 17?
Yeah.
They only cover 11. 13 obviously had some problems and came out, but they don't think about the other moon landings they did.
No.
Well, James is obviously more sophisticated than I am, because I haven't seen that, but I did actually watch Jaws a couple of weeks ago. Glenda and I mean, you know Glenda as well, Andrew, my wife. Glenda said, right, let's put all the Spielberg movies in a pot and draw them out, and we're going to watch all the Spielberg movies. And to be honest with you, some of the ones which are coming out, I didn't even know he'd done. So the last one we watched, talking about conflict, the last one we watched was Duel. What a film. I can remember watching it as a kid. But, I mean, you know, you've got so few characters. You've got really just one person, haven't you? You know, and honestly, I was still on the edge of my seat watching it, even all these years later.
Brilliant. He'll never catch me up the hill.
come on, we can get there, we can get there. Come on, please.
I have no idea what you two are talking about. I'm not.
You got to watch. It's basically a bloke overtakes a lorry. The lorry driver gets a bit jarred off about it. Ultimate road rage.
It's road rage.
The
lorry just hunts him down like a dog. Honestly, it is a great film. Great film.
Classic.
Okay.
So anyway, moving on to our last question, Andrew. The final question we like to ask our guests is, if you could go back in time and speak to an 18-year-old Andrew, what three pearls of wisdom, bits of advice would you give to yourself?
Okay. Again, I thought long and hard about this. But number one would be, do not worry so much. Most of what you worry about will never happen. And even if it does, the sun will still rise the next morning. And you just get over it. Number two, perfection is impossible. And even if it is, it's not the great thing everyone makes it out to be. And there is great beauty to be had in flaws and mistakes. It's what makes us human. And the third one, don't let other people or your own thinking put limits and preconceptions on what you can achieve in life. Shoot like an arrow for what you really want to do.
Three fantastic points. I love those.
Thank you.
Do you want me to close now, James?
Yeah,
agree, James. Three great points. And I think for me, the third one really resonates around, you know, just don't have self-limiting beliefs, but more importantly, don't let other people kind of infiltrate your mind as well, because it's so easy to be influenced by other people, isn't it? In a negative way. So yeah, I love that point. So Andrew, that brings us to the end of the show. Thank you so much for your time. It's been a fascinating insight into the world of public speaking, storytelling, and how you've woven that into your business life as well. If people listening, can someone buzz me? I just said, I'll buzz myself. I said, I did it again. So Andrew, if people want to reach out to you to find out a bit more, want to listen to Stumpy Sanderson's podcast, where can they reach you? And we'll put all of this in the show notes as well.
Oh, thanks. Thanks ever so much, Mark. Well, obviously, the podcasts are available on all major podcast outlets. You can check my website, which is www.stumpysanderson.co.uk. You can find me on Facebook. I've just set up a Facebook page, which is Stumpy Sanderson's 1970s. And every second Tuesday and repeated on the Sunday, you can check in on www.poppylandradio.co.uk for the Stumpy Sanderson's 1970s Stories radio show.
Fantastic.
Brilliant.
And of course, you've got your books as well, Andrew.
Yeah.
Yes, I have, James. Yes. Thank you for mentioning those. That's Talking the Talk and Telling the Tale. They're still available on Amazon. And yes, I've got Talking the Talk available on Kindle as well.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
And just my personal favourite story, Stumpy Sanderson story so far, is Old Faithful. And I think it brings back bad memories of school for myself.
So for the benefit of the listeners, what is that about, Mark?
Sorry, Mark, do you want to?
Well, it's basically about...
Mark, you should surely let Andrew...
Go for it.
Are we talking Breaking Old Reliable here? Breaking Old Reliable.
Sorry, Old Reliable, not Old Faithful. Old Reliable.
It's back in the dark days of... Because obviously I was a child of the 70s. It was back in the dark days of corporal punishment. And there was... Our headmaster had a stick called Old Reliable. And one of our gang, because our stories are all about the five members of our gang, Stephen Brookman, who was a left-wing mastermind and genius dedicated to bringing down the bourgeoisie authoritarianism of the teaching classes at the school, he devised a plot and a plan to smash Old Reliable. And the story is all about this extraordinary attempt to break the headmaster's hold on.
That's such a good one for the listeners to dig into on your podcast series.
So Andrew, fantastic. A massive thank you for the time and the content today. I've really enjoyed it, and I'm sure the listeners have as well. So a massive thank you.
Thanks ever so much, Mark. Thanks, James. And thanks for asking me on this. It's been a real, real pleasure. Great, great fun. And I hope some of what I've been able to, you know, get across is of benefit and help to the listeners.
I'm sure it is, absolutely. Thank you very much, Andrew.
Thanks, James. Thanks, Mark.
James, I really enjoyed that episode. There was such value in there from Andrew, but not just that, but also the fact he was actually bringing it to life by using some of his techniques as well. I found it thoroughly fascinating. I don't know about you.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so relevant to everything that we do. It comes down to the simplicity of communication, how important that is in everything we do. The focus is very much on public speaking, but it's just in everyday life we can use those skills that he was talking about.
Absolutely. As you say, it's not just about when you're delivering a big presentation. It's actually just day-to-day communication with each other. Why would we not look to structure it in the same way? So talking about structuring it in the same way, James, now's the time of the show where we try and pick out our three favourite tips which came out of today, just to draw it out to maybe help guide the listeners in where we saw the value in today as well. So over to you for the first one.
Well, there's loads of areas that we could home in on, but I'm going to pick out as a tip number one, the iceberg analogy, which is, you could hear everything he was saying there. This is not a case of just getting up on stage and rolling out a presentation and hoping for the best. He talked, that this sort of the 10% that you see is the top part of the iceberg is a distraction, really, of the 90% of work that goes into it for all the preparation that he does. He talked around that hour and a half presentations that he was giving, that he repeated 40 times. He practiced 40 times. So I think that's worth bearing in mind. You might only be giving a 5 or 10 minute presentation. It might just be, a footnote to a day's seminar or whatever. But actually, that you've still got to take it really seriously. How many times are you intending to practice your presentation? Once, twice, three times, or how about sort of doubling it, tripling it? Really, honing down that presentation so that you know it well. You've invested in it properly, and then we talked a lot about nerves, but that's a great way, he was saying, of calming the nerves, because competence breeds confidence.
And he used that well-known phrase, didn't he, which is fail to prepare and prepare to fail. And it just ties back into it, doesn't it? Yeah, overnight success and all that stuff. So, yeah, brilliant point. I love that one, James. So over to me for the second one. I love the bit where he talked about how to structure a story. And he talked about ACE. He talked about action, characters and eloquence. And the key thing which really stood out for me there was every story has got to have conflict. Without conflict, you're just effectively just regurgitating words. So, James and Mark have a podcast. James and Mark are competing for who's going to be the lead on their podcast, Leadership and Life Chat.
That's amazing, Mark.
Did you like that? But that was, perhaps we shy away from conflict in conversation sometimes, but adding that element of drama really came through for me, which is that just hooks people in. It makes people want to find out what's going to happen next. They start to buy into the story. So that was huge for me. I loved that point.
Excellent. I'll finish off with the third tip. The key tip coming out of this was he's mentioning, and I know we've talked about this on previous podcasts, but this attention span that we have when we're concentrating on things. And if you're in the audience, it's around 10 to 11 minutes before people start thinking of other things. So trying to factor that in, if you've got an hour's presentation, perhaps, well, maybe, sort of 10 minutes of focus in a particular area, and then you need to give the audience a bit of a break. Now, I'm not talking about coffee break or whatever. You're talking about switching up the styles, maybe leading into a story, so that it just refreshes the presentation before you go again and you hit them with another sort of 10 minutes of detail. So trying to look at not an hour in entirety, but how you're going to break that down into bite-sized chunks almost for people to be able to digest.
Yeah, brilliant. So that, I mean, there was a lot more points, James, and we'll capture those in the show notes. We'll put some timings in. We'll really help the audience drive into the points that Andrew was bringing out. So, thanks again to Andrew. That was awesome. I really, really enjoyed that. Hopefully you did as well. So if you really enjoyed this, please share the podcast with your friends. We'd love to spread the word wider and further, just to help the show grow so we can help more people. So as James, as you said in the trailer for this series, for those who've listened to it, we now have a voice notes option on our website for people to leave us a message. And we would love to hear feedback on what you took out of today's show, anything you'd like to perhaps hear more on, or any just thoughts you've got about it, please leave it, and we'll feature you on the next recording. We'll bring it out, and we'll bring that point to life, and we'll talk around it a bit. So please feel free to visit our website in the show notes and leave a voicemail. And the very final thing, James, this show wouldn't have been possible without our sponsors, Larking Gowen Business Advisors and Chartered Accountants. So a massive thank you to Larking Gowen. Check out the website to see the services and how they can help you. So that brings us to the end of today's show, James. Thank you. It was a great one. Really enjoyed it.
Me too. Can't wait for the next one.
See you soon. Thanks, everybody. Mark. Bye.